Okay, so today's class is on viral meningitis. I'm going to combine my next lecture, polio, also with it together. So you must have heard this term, aseptic meningitis. It's kind of an older term, but it generally signifies meningitis where other common causes of meningitis has not been found. Right. So generally it is characterized with lymphocytic pleocytosis, that is number of cells that to lymphocytes increases in CSF, and the bacterial culture is generally sterile. There are a few terms that you should be aware of, which is meningitis and encephalitis. Meningitis is inflammation of meninges, which is the outer covering of the brain, and encephalitis is where there is inflammation of brain parenchyma. Meningitis is primarily being divided as based on etiological agent. It could be bacterial, tubercular, viral or fungal. If you'll broadly see and try to differentiate them based on its clinical and some laboratory parameters. In laboratory parameters, we'll see that bacterial has maximum number of WBC rise, and generally the cell type is neutrophilic. And the glucose is reduced and the protein is increased. In tubercular as well, the number are increased, not as compared to seen in bacterial, and the cell rise is generally lymphocytic. In viral, there is increased number of cells which are predominantly lymphocytic. But if you'll see, the protein rise is not as high compared as tubercular. In fungal also, we see increased number of cells with lymphocytic predominance. So there are different causes of bacterial versus viral meningitis and encephalitis. You've already had classes on bacterial meningitis. So we are going to concentrate basically on viral causes today. Among viral encephalitis, where brain parenchyma is involved, you are going to have a separate class. But the most common cause of sporadic viral encephalitis is herpes simplex viruses. Among viral meningitis, the most common cause are enteroviruses. So this is just listing all the causes of acute meningitis, whether it is bacterial, atypical organisms, viruses or parasitic. Among the viral causes, we can see that enteroviruses being the most common are followed by various arboviruses, herpes viruses, LCMV. There could be aseptic meningitis like featured in during HIV, adenoviruses, parainfluenza viruses, and these are the rarer causes, and influenza and measles viruses. So in pathogenesis of meningitis, the infection can occur through various routes. It could be hematogenous spread, that is, it is spread through blood, reaches blood-brain barrier through blood, or it is a retrograde axonal, that is, through the nerve root. It generally enters through nasopharynx and through cribriform plate, through olfactory nerve. It transcends upwards and can reach the brain. Now the common causes of after the causes, there are common clinical features seen in meningitis are fever, headache, neck stiffness and photophobia. And the signs of meningeal irritation, which are seen often with during examination, are nuchal rigidity, which is nothing but there is neck stiffness or there is difficulty in bending the head. Then there are certain examination signs which you would be seeing and eliciting during your practical postings are Kernick signs and Rudzinski's sign. Now, just to understand different viruses and which families they belong to, which are involved in causing meningitis, the family Picornaviridae has this genus Enterovirus, which has various species inside it. And these are the ones which are commonly implicated in meningitis. I'm going to feature more on Picornaviridae because in today's class I'm going to elaborate more on polioviruses. Which are Thank you. So Picornaviridae itself is a huge family. It involves almost all organ system and it causes various syndrome. As listed today, aseptic meningitis or viral meningitis can be seen with polioviruses, meningococci viruses, echoviruses and other common enteroviruses. In the spectrum of Picornaviridae, We know that paralysis or acute flaccid paralysis, which is what we call the presentation of polio. There are several other enteroviruses which are involved apart from polioviruses as well, and these are becoming increasingly important since the polioviruses has been eradicated from most of the world, right? So there are other clinical syndrome which you should be aware of, and these are common questions which can be asked where enteroviruses are implicated, like herpingina, hand foot mouth disease, pleurodynia, myocarditis, pericarditis, acute hemorrhagic conjunctivitis, rhinitis and pneumonitis, right? So enteroviruses, as being the leading cause, generally present with similar features: fever, vomiting, anorexia, rash. There could be preceding URTI with meningeal signs, and in some cases it can actually get complicated. In majority of cases, they are actually sort of self-limiting. They resolve without any specific therapy, just supportive management. The clinical course is less severe, as you see in bacterial meningitis, but in some severe forms, especially in neonates, we can have hepatic necrosis, myocarditis, necrotizing enterocolitis or encephalitis. In children and adults, other than these features, we can also have vomiting, rash, diarrhea, cough, pharyngitis, as well as myalgia. Now, enteroviruses are generally seasonal viruses. They predominate during certain seasons, so you can actually have community outbreaks of these illnesses, where patients can have rash, conjunctivitis and other syndromes that we discussed of enteroviruses. Right, other common virus we said involved in viral meningitis are herpes viruses, and this belongs to family herpes viridae, where they have been classified further as subfamilies alpha, beta, gamma, and it has 8 viruses, where HSV-1, HSV-2, VZV are commonly in the alpha subfamily. Of these, most important is HSV-2, which is involved in causing meningitis. You remember that HSV-1 is the most common cause of encephalitis, sporadic encephalitis, while for meningitis, the most common cause is HSV-2, right? HSV-2, we know that both HSV-1 and 2 can cause oral lesion as well as genital lesions. There is a, you can say, predominance of HSV-1 causing oral lesion and HSV-2 causing genital lesion, right? There was this concept of above the belt and below the belt infection, though this straightforward line is no longer true, but there is a predominance of one type in causing certain lesions. So HSV-2 is the one which generally gets transmitted to a neonate during parturition from a woman who's infected. And HSV infection, as we know, in women are often asymptomatic. There could be reactivation and shedding, so they can be actually asymptomatically get transferred to a baby, where a child would be presenting as meningitis or encephalitis like complication. So the most common problem associated are urinary retention, dysesthesias, paresthesias, neuralgias, parapresis, and other issues. Then among herpes viruses, you can also have EBV meningitis. Epstein-Barr virus, if you'll remember, causes something called infectious mononucleosis. It's the most common cause of this clinical syndrome, which is associated with pharyngitis, lymphadenopathy, and splenomegaly. Varicella zoster virus, which is the cause of chickenpox as a primary infection, as a reactivation which causes herpes zoster, can also cause meningitis during its clinical illness, and it is associated with vesicular rash. Then there is another special term which has been associated with HSV-2, less frequently with HSV-1, which is called Mollerets meningitis, where this meningitis-like illness is actually become recurrent. And it's often benign, and definitely it resolves in its own, but it's a recurrent episodic in nature which happens. So 3 to 10 episodes of fever with meningeal irritation, generally lasting 2 to 5 days and with spontaneous recovery. Another important cause of meningitis has been mumps. Mumps is a virus which is from the family Paramyxoviridae. If you'll remember, it causes peritonitis with parotid swelling. And generally, other than the salivary gland enlargement, you can also have meningitis-like feature in some people, and you can actually elicit history of pre-existing or mumps happening just before this onset of meningeal irritation like features. And there would be these features. Generally, this disease is benign and self-limiting. then it can occur as a part of primary HIV infection, or as can also be caused by LCMV, lymphocytic chorioamnionitis virus. It's another rare virus which is generally zoonotic in origin. It's generally associated with rats. And here also the biphasic sort of illness with headache, photophobia can occur, and there could be other rarer complication like arthritis, orchitis or myopericarditis. So now regarding its lab diagnosis, if you want to diagnose other than the clinical features, the examination where you can elicit certain signs and certain important points in history, the diagnosis needs to be confirmed, and the mainstay of diagnosis is generally molecular identification on CSF samples. Right. So different samples which can be taken, CSF is the most common, blood or urine can also be some supplementary diagnosis samples. You'll remember CSF, which is present in the subarachnoid space. A lumbar puncture procedure is performed where you'll take 2 to 5 ml of CSF in a sterile leak-proof container. Remember, all sterile samples will go into sterile containers, and it should be wide mouth, it should be properly labeled and should be transported in the lab as early as possible. But if you'll also remember, all these viruses, and especially those which are used for molecular diagnosis, they are very sensitive, they are very temperature labile, so they need to be kept at maintaining the cold chain. So they should be stored at 2 to 8 degree Celsius temperature, that is, they should be sent in an ice box, and for long-term storage they can be stored at minus 70 degree freezers. Regarding CSF sample collection, often at the time of clinical features and examination we are not able to differentiate whether it is viral or bacterial or some other cause. So what we need to do is actually divide the CSF sample into several containers, which can be then be sent to different labs as per your differential diagnosis. So one set will always go to biochemistry for glucose and protein estimation. One will go for cytology to check the number of cells and the type of cell predominance. And a third portion will go for microbiological investigation. Even in this part, if you're taking a CSF sample, you actually need to divide it into two parts. One part should be for viral diagnosis, which should be kept at 4 degrees Celsius. If there is a chance of delay, you can keep it at refrigerator and then send to the lab in a cold chain. And another set has to be kept at room temperature. Why? Because this set needs to go for bacterial investigation. Because some of the bacteria like Haemophilus influenzae, which are cause of meningitis, bacterial meningitis, they are even more temperature labile because they cannot survive at lower temperature, at 4 degrees. So if you'll send this CSF sample, which has been maintained at other temperatures other than the room temperature, and you'll send it for culture, the bacteria will not be able to grow. So you'll get a false negative in this case. Right, so this is the table that I showed you earlier, that you can actually take from cytology examination, from biochemistry examination. You can broadly understand that what type of infection that you are looking at. To know the abnormal, you also need to know the normal. So you should know that CSF normally will have some cells, generally 0 to 5 cells, and these cells are predominantly lymphocytes, they are not neutrophils. Right. So neutrophils in CSF sample generally indicate some infective or some inflammatory etiology. Right. Another important thing to note here is this typical picture of cell type predominance generally occur at a specific period. So if a lumbar puncture is done, generally within 48 hours of onset of symptoms, this typical picture may not be seen. So if you've taken a sample too early, you can have a different picture, and after 48 hours you might get this picture. Also, if some sort of treatment has been initiated during this phase, you might not see this typical pattern, right? So you should be aware of all the fallacies also of various intervention which may be needed. We talked about this part where the sample has been divided and sent for different labs for investigation, and this is a very crucial step. Other modes of diagnosis which remain in laboratory diagnosis, if you broadly classify, our microscopy, culture, serology and molecular. In diagnosis of meningitis, culture is of no use because it has very low sensitivity. Serology is an option, but it's not very helpful, right? You can do some serological investigation for enteroviruses, but they have very low specificity right? And they're not very definitive, and they can have, you can have, person can have cross-reactive antibodies as well. Molecular investigation, that is PCR, remains the mainstay of diagnosis because these are most sensitive and specific assay. Now regarding treatment, we talked about that majority of these illnesses are self-limiting and they are going to resolve on its own. So the management is generally supportive. For HSV and VZV, IV acyclovir can be given. There are certain other drugs which have been tested, like for piconazole has been tried for enteroviruses, but the effect has not been very beneficial. Right, and there has been no specific antivirals for many of these illnesses. Right, so this was regarding viral meningitis or aseptic meningitis. I'm combining this lecture with poliovirus lecture because actually there is quite an overlap, because the most common organism here is Picornia viridae family, which also has polioviruses. So this lecture actually combines and makes you understand all the whole of the spectrum of enteroviruses, right? So poliovirus, a very important virus for us to know, as these are the pictures. If you can see, this is this person is Franklin D. Roosevelt. He was the 32nd president of USA. It's important to see him here to identify, because he was one person who was inflicted with paralytic polio, and he also did establish many national foundation for help in polio research in future. If you'll remember, you can see this desk. It's a very famous picture. You often see him sitting behind this huge desk in Oval Office in US President Office, and they often place some sort of table or something in front of it, because oftentimes he's actually wearing external calipers in these pictures. Right, this is the brief layout of the lecture. We'll start with a bit of introduction. Polio is not a new disease. It has been there for centuries. If even in that those Egyptian time, you can see this person who has a weakened leg and who has a stick. Right. So even in those time, illnesses which were likely polio were existent. But the research part became important because in 1909, the infection was experimentally transmitted to primates. So it was identified that it is actually transmissible illness. The mainstay of the push towards its identification, as well as the further research and vaccine, actually came about with isolating this virus in cell culture, which was done by Ender, Willers and Robbins, and they also received Nobel Prize for it. There are two types of successful vaccines which have come up for polio. One is the killed vaccine called soft vaccine, and another is the Sebin vaccine, which is the oral polio vaccine. These are the ones who experimentally transmitted polio to monkeys by inoculating spinal cord and fecal extract filtrates from fatal cases of polio, right? So with animal experimentation, they proved that it is an infectious etiology. And further, these scientists, Enders, Willers and Robbins, isolated them, and they were able to isolate in non-neural cells. So that is what it was really important, because just isolating them in neural cells or propagating in them in laboratory animals was not sufficient enough to develop antigen or vaccine further. Salk, very famous obviously because he was the first vaccine which came about for polio, and then it was the Sebin oral polio vaccine. Again, this taxonomy classification I've already showed you earlier. These are the viruses from Picornia viridae family, and in the genus Enterovirus, you have poliovirus 1, 2, 3 which are existent. Within the Enterovirus genus, you also have rhinoviruses. Rhinoviruses, if you'll remember, are the most common cause of rhinitis, right? And there are hundreds of rhinoviruses which are existent. There are other genuses within this family of human importance are parvoviruses, which do cause some of those illness which I showed you in that table, and there are hepatoviruses, which include hepatitis A virus, so one of the hepatitis causing viruses transmitted through fecal-oral route, right? So you can see predominantly these are transmitted through fecal-oral route, and some of these are actually transmitted through a respiratory route as well. Right, so after that classification, this is just a look at the revised classification, where genus Enteroviruses has been further divided into many species, and what they have done is they have actually clubbed poliovirus separately of its importance. So within the poliovirus you have three types of polioviruses, 1, 2, 3, and all other enteroviruses have been clubbed as human enterovirus A, human enterovirus B, C, D and four. So all those numbers which had earlier been given for coxsackieviruses and enteroviruses have now been classified within these groups. So, for example, this enterovirus 68, which was previously called, is often called human enterovirus D68. So, D68, if you remember, it was also in the news, was one of the important virus which has been implicated with acute flaccid myelitis. So, again, this table I showed you earlier of different clinical syndrome which has been associated with Picorna viridae, where paralysis or acute flaccid paralysis commonly associated with polioviruses 1, 2, 3, but can also be seen with other enteroviruses, mainly coxsackievirus 79, A79, coxsackievirus B25, certain other echoviruses and enteroviruses 70, 71 and parvovirus 3. So poliovirus in the Picorna viridae family, it's in a virion which is very small in size, it's about 30 nanometer and it is icosahedral symmetry. Its genome is single-stranded positive sense RNA, which is linear. It's a non-enveloped virus. It is stable at acidic pH and it has the surface capsid protein, which are VP1, VP2, VP3 and VP4 is the internal protein. If you'll remember, all the viruses or majority of the viruses which are transmitted through fecal-oral route are generally non-enveloped, right? Because envelopes, especially envelope in a virus, are very labile, so they get dissolved with detergents or acids. So with their stability, actually a non-enveloped nature is more beneficial to them, and they also survive in the acidic pH, so they can they'll be remain stable at gastric pH and they'll be able to elicit infection in the gastrointestinal tract. So briefly on its replication, this virus, when it is taken up by the cell, will release its, remember there is no envelope, right? So it's the capsid protein which will dissolve and the RNA would be released with its genomic segment, a protein which has been attached to it. Since it's a positive sense RNA, positive sense means positive sense RNA means that this RNA is capable of forming a polyprotein on its own, right? It doesn't has to be first converted into its complementary copy. So positive sense RNA are called infectious RNA because when you put it inside the cell, they'll be able to form its protein copies directly. So this protein can act as an mRNA, form a polyprotein, and there will be proteolytic digestion to form various different protein component in it. The initial proteins are generally non-structural, followed by structural proteins, and a small part of those RNA initially will also form its complementary copy to further form the RNA genome in the progeny. This would all be actually combined together with different proteins and will form a new virion, which would be here it is being incapacitated, and this would be released from the cells after causing cell lysis or after damaging the cell. So different antigenic types are being identified, poliovirus 1, 2, 3 based on its neutralization assay or based on its neutralization property. The immunity in poliovirus is said to be type specific, right? So person who's infected with type 1 will become immune to type 1 but not to the other two. So that is why immunity against all three is important, and that is why vaccination strategy will always involve all three together, right? Among these three, one has been seen to be most common associated with epidemic, two with endemic, right? We strike variation in these. Last case of wild poliovirus type 2 was identified in 99, and last case of poliovirus type 3 was in November 2012. So this is the virus which has been eradicated often from most of the world. And in its pathogenesis, it's also important to remember that the receptor which is being utilized by poliovirus is CD155, which is a transmembrane glycoprotein. Normally, this receptor is involved in intercellular adherence junction, but this receptor is being utilized by viruses to gain entry into the cell. The pathogenesis, the transmission is fecal-oral, as we discussed the initial replication is occurring after ingesting this virus, generally through contaminated water or some food stores. It will replicate in the epithelium of the gut, in the lymphatic Peyer's patches. It also replicate in the early phase in the tonsillar material and in the regional nodes. After this local replication, you have a phase of primary viremia where it will disseminate into the bloodstream and it will go to various organs. So it mainly now multiply in the macrophage monocyte system, which includes lymph nodes, spleen and other lymphatic materials. After this replication at these specific lymphoid organs, a secondary viremia ensues, and during the secondary viremia is when you have the mainly the infection of the CNS. The through retrograde neuronal transport, it will enter through various peripheral nerves, and it will enter it will gain entry into the central nervous system as well. So among its spectrum of clinical disease, it's the children who are most often associated. It is so children between 6 months to 3 years, so less than 5 years children are the most susceptible. The incubation period of this virus ranges from 7 to 14 days. Most of the infection here are actually subclinical, so asymptomatic versus symptomatic, there is a huge you can see difference. 90 to 95% infections are subclinical. Why is it important to know is because if you get even a single case of paralytic polio in community, that indicates that there are 100 to 1000 asymptomatic cases already in the community, right? So that is why preventive effort and those vaccination boosts is especially important if you get even a single case of paralytic polio. Now, among its disease presentation, you can have a mild disease, a non-paralytic polio, paralytic poliomyelitis. Mild disease is generally which occurs during the phase of primary viremia, where patient can have fever, pharyngitis, malaise, and patient recover on its own. In non-paralytic poliomyelitis, there is aseptic meningitis-like feature. We talked about that poliovirus can be cause of aseptic or viral meningitis. So this can occur during this phase. This phase is also self-limiting. Patient recover and completely in most of the cases. In paralytic poliomyelitis, which occur in less than 1% of those infected, patient will have lower motor neuronal damage and they'll present with acute flaccid paralysis. Rarely brainstem can also be involved, so it can be fatal in those cases. Generally, it is the focal paralysis which will extend in next 3 to 4 days. Maximum recovery occurs within 6 months, and though in some muscles you can have residual paralysis. So quadriceps is one of the most common groups which are involved in paralytic poliomyelitis. There is another entity called progressive post-poliomyelitis muscle atrophy, which is actually a recrudescence of paralysis and muscle wasting. So after somebody had paralytic polio, there is some gain in the movement. Decades after, there is a sudden deterioration. It's not said to be due to, it's important to know, because it's not due to viral reactivation. It's actually some physiological changes which are associated with aging. So the compensatory changes which has been taken over by other muscle group gets weakened with age. So patient can have sudden deterioration in muscle strength. Right. So this is a composite, you can say PIC, which will show you this illness, where you can have the phase where the early phase which coincide with primary viremia, where you can have fever, headache, sore throat, and the neural phase also can ensue, where you'll have those aseptic meningitis like features, right? And it's also important here because important to know, because if you want to diagnose a case, it's important to know which sample to take based on where the virus is going to be present at what stage of illness, right? So so initially you can have a virus which is present in even in throat secretion. For example, in the early phase you can get samples from tonsil that can also be positive, or in the later phase, or the one which would be going to be most common is going to be fecal shedding of the virus. So it starts from the early phase and persists very long, even after the paralytic polio stage has set in, right? So broadly, the differential diagnosis for acute plastic paralysis. Enteroviruses, polio are among the most common causes, but there could be other viral causes like adenoviruses, West Nile viruses, and often 20% or so of rabies can also present as paralytic rabies. Right? There are other causes like botulism or some post-viral or para-infectious sort of etiology like transverse myelitis, GBS, traumatic neuritis, that can also happen. And some other differential are syndrome, snake bite or chemical poisoning. In lab diagnosis, we said ki, it's again depend on when the patient has come to you. The samples which can be of use is feces, blood, throat swab or CSF. Right, so if it's an aseptic meningitis phase, CSF would be important. In the early phase, a throat swab would also be helpful, but often we do not get patients so early. The most important sample remains feces, where the viral shedding is occurring at a very high level, and that too for a very long period. Right. So similarly with other lab diagnosis, here again microscopy will not be of use. Cell culture has been utilized in polio for different reasons. The common cell culture which has been used are primary monkey kidney, RD, human rhabdomyosarcoma cells, and L20B, which are mouse derived cells, or HEP2 cells. Right. In the infected viral culture, you can see characteristic cytopathic effect. Right, you can see these small rounding and clustering which can happen. And these further can be identified by performing some confirmatory test on the cell culture like microneutralization assays. Another important mainstay for fecal sample is our molecular assay, where you can perform a PCR test. So this is an RNA virus, so the test is going to be reverse transcriptase PCR, and sequencing for VP1 gene can also happen. Right. So another method which can be used as serology, though it's again not very helpful because a lot of cross reactive antibodies and it has low specificity. Regarding polio, you should be aware there is an acute flaccid paralysis surveillance which had been happening earlier. All children with AFP with less than 15 years need to collect two stool samples which are at least 24 hours apart and within 14 days of onset of paralysis, and these samples need to be sent to a WHO accredited polio network lab, and which will confirm you whether they have identified polio virus in the stool sample or not. So in Delhi, NCDC is one of the lab which is in the polio network lab. So now regarding its prophylaxis, vaccine is very important. Antibody or giving passive immunity has been found as no role. The active immunity can be gained by vaccines, and we talked about there are two types of vaccines, SOC, which are killed, which are injectable vaccine, and generally these are formalin inactivated vaccines, and other is the live virus vaccine or the 7 oral polio vaccine, which could either be monovalent, bivalent or trivalent. It's very important for, since it's a live virus, that this vaccine is maintained in a cold chain, so that, remember, it's very temperature sensitive, and you also need to give repeated doses so that immunity is generated against each of those polio virus type. It's also important to know that for those inactivated viruses, it's also important to properly inactivate the virus. So there was this huge incident called Qatar incident in USA, where they gave polio vaccines, but it was improperly inactivated, and these vaccines, which retained its virulence, ended up causing 40,000 cases of polio, including killing 10 people. Now broadly, we need to understand IPV versus OPV, the differences. The IPV are formalin inactivated, the OPVs are the live vaccines. The immunity is high in both, but the intestinal immunity or local immunity can only be given by the oral polio vaccine, right? Because it's given since the virus is transmitted fecal-orally, you need local immunity at the gastrointestinal site. So this vaccine is generally given by oral dosing, so it will be able to produce local immunity at the gastrointestinal site or mucosal immunity. The herd immunity concept also comes into play with the live vaccine. So OPV is able to provide that herd immunity. Herd immunity is nothing but if sufficient number of people in a population are immune, this will interrupt the chain of transmission. So even if you're not able to get all the 100% of people immune, even if you sufficiently get 70 to 80% of people immune, the virus will not be able to transmit successfully in this population. There is also something called vaccine-associated paralytic polio. So this has been seen with oral vaccines, because these are live vaccines. So live vaccines have lost its virulence, right? But it's still able to replicate. So when something replicates, it's actually capable of reverting back and gaining its virulence back, right? So there is a threat or risk of this happening with live vaccine, so which could be an important issue. Also, live vaccines cannot be given in an immunodeficient person, right? And obviously, the cost issue also remains with these. There are certain laboratory features which can actually differentiate the wild strain with the vaccine strain. Why this is important? Because if you're doing you have sent this sample for identification, it's able to either culture a polio virus or able to do a PCR, is able to detect this polio virus. We need to know that whether this polio virus actually originated from a wild strain, which is a virulent pathogenic strain, or it is actually the vaccine strain, because you're also giving vaccine to the population, right? So these are important when you are able for laboratory identification. Pulse polio immunization has been something that's been happening. It's generally a immunization day where all the children less than 5 years are immunized on a single day. And again, the target here is that it does not replace the routine immunization, which is already happening. So you should be aware of the routine immunization schedule. But the idea is to at one day flood whole of the population with the vaccine polio strain. So it is able to actually displace the wild strain from the environment. And obviously, the herd immunity concept also is important here, because it's able to create that herd immunity so that the transmission is further stopped. I told you this entity called vaccine-associated paralytic polio, which can happen with live viruses. So there are also these terms which will also be coming across, which is VDPV, or vaccine-derived polioviruses, or circulating vaccine-derived polioviruses. So just going into brief, the VAP is actually cases of paralytic poliomyelitis among the recipients or their contact. It's actually an adverse event of the vaccine itself, though the risk of spread to others are very less, right? So contact is very less. It's basically mostly happening in the recipient itself. The of which is more important is our VDPVs, or vaccine derived polioviruses, which are actually genetically divergent emergence of VDPVs, which occur. And generally in the people who are immunodeficient or in the areas where the OPV coverage is really low. So these viruses tend to multiply. So remember, these are live viruses which replicate, they multiply, they mutate, they become genetically diverge from their original, the vaccine strain. So generally the sequence divergence is more than 1% from their parental vaccine OPV strain. So with this divergence, some different properties can also be gained by this virus. So that is why it's important. It has been grouped into three types: circulating, immunodeficiency associated, and one where the cause is not known, is called ambiguous. We also need to understand that polio has had a global epidemiological change. Polio was a disease which was endemic in more than 125 countries in the 1980s, but of late, due to implementation of successful vaccination, the numbers have drastically reduced. If you see in 2002, it was still there in India, and if you see in later years, it is only existent now in few countries in the world, right? Of these countries, as you can see here, the cases in 2018 wild cases remained in Afghanistan and Pakistan, two countries where it's still there. There was this another African countries where there were still cases earlier, in Nigeria, which is now actually not reported some cases. So you need to have actually virus, no detection of wild cases for consecutive 3 years to call it actually free of the virus. Though since OPV vaccination is still given in all these countries, CVDPVs, or circulating vaccine-derived poliovirus strains, keep being identified in these other countries where OPV is still being given as part of routine immunization. So it's also important to understand that we probably not have full freedom from the vaccine till OPV is still in our schedule. So the idea for majority of these countries is to actually phase out live vaccines or OPVs and to include IPVs into their routine immunization schedule. Right, so we can see that India actually reported last case in 2011, and after that we have not reported any cases of wild polio virus. Right. So after that Jan 2011, this last case, which was of polio virus 1, we have not reported any case and we were free from circulation, and India was removed from the list of polio endemic countries in 2012, and 2014 we achieved our goal of polio eradication, which was a huge milestone. Right, so we are now in the phase where we are talking about polio eradication and endgame strategic plan. This endgame objectives include early detection of virus and interruption of any transmission. The routine immunization needs to be strengthened, and this point that we were just discussing, that oral polio vaccine need to be withdrawn with introduction of IPV. Right, so first IPV would be introduced in a phased manner. After trivalent, we'll switch to bivalent OPVs, and then we completely withdraw oral polio vaccines, right? Containment and obviously planning also is involved in the endgame plans. These are the further goals which have been identified. The main goal is to stop all circulating VDPVs outbreaks within 120 days of detection and eliminate any risk of emergence of future VDPVs. So India has now launched inactivated polio vaccine in its schedule, and it has been done in phased manner in certain states, and now been expanded to most of the other states, including it in our national immunization schedule. Now this term AFP linked with polio virus was in existence. Now there is another term which recently came called acute flaccid myelitis. So because it mainly is involving the gray matter of spinal cord with the sudden onset of limb weakness, generally unilateral. This was reported first in USA in 2014. This illness was found something similar to polio virus, but here the cause was actually found to be different. So non-polio enteroviruses, mainly D68 and sometimes A71, has been implicated in presentation of acute flaccid myelitis. So in this sort of outbreak, D68 was the one which was most often commonly associated with acute flaccid myelitis. So this was all regarding this lecture. It's also important for us to know that since COVID has come, there has been world over, there's been interruption of vaccine services and healthcare services to all those nations which are still reporting polio cases. So there is a risk or a threat that these diseases may come back, because the vaccination services which had to be given at regular intervals is not being done at present. So hopefully that is something which we'll be able to recover after this lockdown is over, world over, and everything is back into place, right? So thank you so much, and if any questions, I think your CR can have our number, so if you have any query we can have the discussion. So I know this communication part is lacking here, but hopefully we can resolve that also. Thank you.